To worship this morning, glad that you're here. I want to start us off with a word of scripture. It's from Lamentations chapter 3. Even if you don't know anything about the book of Lamentations, you can tell by the title it's a heavy book. It's about heartache, suffering, and grief. It's five chapters long, and the scripture that most people know from this book. It's often quoted. It's very well known. You'll probably recognize it once I read it. But what I only learned quite recently, really, is that this amazing, like the whole, if you were just to color the Book of Lamentations, it's all black except for one spot, and it's right in the middle. And I never really realized it. The whole thing is built around this central ray of light from the Lord in Lamentations 3. And this is what the prophet Jeremiah, who wrote it, said, "Yet this I will call to mind," after, you know, 2.5 chapters of darkness. "I will call this to mind, and therefore I have hope. Because of the Lord's great love, we are not consumed. For his compassions never fail. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. I say to myself, the Lord is my portion. Therefore, I will wait for him." And I read that this morning because we're a diverse group of people, and so you might be coming in this morning carrying a lot of weight. It might be a very dark kind of morning for you, or it might be a bright morning. It might be a cheerful morning, or sort of just kind of average. Whatever the case may be, I hope that you will be able to come in and say, the reason that it's good to gather is because the Lord's compassions never fail. That's what I'm going to depend upon this morning. That's what I'm depending on myself this morning. I encourage you to do the same, and I invite you to stand with us as we sing our morning hymn to start our morning together.
First morning, blackbird has spoken like the first bird. Praise for the singing, praise for the morning, praise for them singing fresh from. Thank you.
All right. Well, good morning. Welcome to worship. My name is Ryan. I'm one of the pastors here. And if you're new or visiting, we're glad you're with us. Welcome. I had a crazy thing happen last night, and I'm still trying to get my mind around it. I've talked to a bunch of people, and I haven't solved it. We had a visitor come to our house last night at about 1:30 in the morning and tried to light our house on fire. I know. Yeah, that's not great. And so I'm still a little bit shell-shocked, as you might expect, and it's kind of coloring everything I'm thinking about this morning. And they're going, wow, okay, that was not great. But of course, the police and the fire folks came out, and we didn't have any real damage, some marks on the wall. But that's where I'm coming from this morning, and I hope that you're coming from a happier spot than that. But wherever we're at, right, we're okay, I'm here to worship the Lord. I'm here to honor him, and that's what we're going to do, even in spite of whatever circumstances what we're showing up with, right? And so, I encourage you to have that same plan, even if you don't feel it all the way, right? Say, no, Lord, I'm going to be here to hear from you and to respond in worship. A couple announcements. First of all, we've been talking for a few weeks, but we are hosting a grief share class. This is a support group, a short-term life group for anyone who's lost a loved one, a family member, and is grieving. It would be helpful to grieve with others, to have other people who are helping you walk with the Lord through a season of grief. And so if you're interested, it starts Wednesday, March 15th from 6:15 to 8:15. It's happening at the U.S. Digital Building, which is over on 136, just down the way. We'd love to have you be a part of it. If you want to be a part of it, you can grab one of these green response cards, put your information on there, and let us know, and then we will be in touch. Also, new news. The weekend of Easter, we are having a baptism service, which is exciting. We decided that let's take our busiest weekend, and then let's make it even busier. But it's going to be awesome. What a cool time to be baptized on Resurrection Sunday, right? And so that's going to happen. If you are wanting to be baptized, would love to let us know. Again, grab one of these green cards, put your information on it. And I would just say, if you're a believer, if you've trusted Jesus and you have not been baptized, then you should be baptized, and this would be a great opportunity to do it. And that's, if you're 8 years old or if you're 80 years old, you are invited. And anything between as well, right? You're invited. To be baptized. And so I encourage you to consider that. Now, if you are brand new, then when I talk about phase two, you don't know what that means. But what phase two is we own the properties that are just right connected to the church building here, property, and we are planning to expand our facility out that way. And we got some really good news this week. Pastor Toby and Bob Pearson and our architect Lisa Slater all met with the city, which is always really fun, working on permits, right, and getting all that stuff squared away. And I don't understand all the details. You could ask him, and he probably mostly does. You can ask Lisa. She really understands it, but she's not here. But the bottom line is that they and a number of things where there could have been a problem, they waved it, said, it's all right. It's all right. Huge blessing. It could have been a sticking point on even going forward with the project or changing, making major changes to what we had planned. And they said, no, it'll be all good. That's so cool. And then on the a particular kind of permit that Lisa expected we would need to get, the city decided, actually, you can get this other much simpler permit. And the permit that Lisa thought we were going to have to get would cost, with all the work that goes into getting that permit, around $50,000. So the city gave us a $50,000 gift to phase two this week. So that's pretty cool. That's pretty cool. So I thought, I was super encouraged. I figured others would be as well. Speaking of giving, I just want to realize, one thing we never really talk about is giving. And if you're new, and you might say, so how does giving even work at this church? Because it's just not, before COVID, we used to pass a plate, and then that became illegal. And so we don't pass a plate anymore. And we just never started again. I don't know. We just never started back up. But there's a few different ways people give. And I'm not saying any of this because, man, we're just really short on money and we're nothing like that at all. This is no plea or push to give more. It's just, hey, if you're new, you should know how this works. There's a box in the foyer, and there's these envelopes. So some people put cash or checks in there, put your name on it. Great way to do it. Others do through online bill pay. It shows up in the mail every week. We have a locked mailbox that keeps it nice and secure. And then others, through our website or through the app, you can sign up and set up either a one-time or a recurring payment using a debit or a credit card, and that works super well also. And there's four different budgets that you have that you can choose to give toward, and primarily encourage everyone to give toward the general fund, because that is what all the need, you know, that keeps the lights on, right? And it keeps everything in operation, all the plans we have for ministry. But then also there are some other options. There's a fellowship fund, and that just goes, it's good to know about that as well. That helps people in our congregation who have a need. And we're able to help people all the time. It's a really cool thing. People let us know, hey, you know, situation came up. Here's where we're at. We could really use a boost, and we're able to give a boost because we all have collectively said we're going to give to that so that people in our congregation are cared for. And that fund is really healthy, and it's really good. There's also the Phase 2 fund, which will help pay for this extension I talked about. There is, and then there's missions. And missions fund goes for all sorts of different mission projects that come up throughout the year that are not planned, but we have our missionaries, they're always contacting us saying, hey, if you happen to find some loose change, we got some ideas. We have some things that we think would be really cool. And so we're able to bless them and be a part of the mission stuff that God's up to around the world through funds that come in directly to the missions fund. And I'll talk about a specific thing on that next week. So that's a cliffhanger. But what I'm going to do now is we're going to stand, and we're going to read our catechism question, answer, and scripture. So I invite you to stand with me. All right, so the question is this. What does God require in the fourth and fifth commandments? Fourth, that on the Sabbath day we spend time in worship of God. Fifth, that we love and honor our father and our mother. Leviticus 19:3. Every one of you shall revere his mother and his father, and you shall keep my Sabbaths. I am the Lord your God. All right. We'll invite you to turn and talk to someone next to you, and the kids, you are dismissed to class upstairs.
All right, please find your places and stand to your feet. We're going to sing an old song. This is a classic chorus. It's been sung for many years. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back, no turning back. How many of you have that in your heritage? Okay, that's so we're gonna pick it up a little.
Have a seat, church. That's a really, really sweet song to sing. There's an incredible story that goes with how that song was written. I don't have time for it this morning, but you should go and research it. That's why I'm telling you about it. Go and look up I've Decided to Follow Jesus and read about the backstory to that song. Sometimes the best songs that we can sing as a congregation are like the simplest truth sung over and over again, because we really need those to get ingrained into our hearts. So love singing that with the saints. My name is Ryan. I'm one of the other Ryan, one of the pastors here. And this morning we get to turn the page into a new section of the Torah. This is a really monumental chapter in the Torah, and it really changes the direction of the whole narrative. Just to briefly recap what we've seen so far, Genesis 1 through 11, in chapters 1 and 2, we kind of summarize that as seeing God's glorious world, as God makes and orders the world and creates order out of chaos and then puts vice regents over the world, humanity, to rule it and to keep it and subdue it and to go and to fill it. Right? And so I wish that we could just like stay there in Genesis 1 through 2 and bask in that for a really long time. But we get to Genesis chapter 3, and chapters 3 through 11 are marked by the devastation of God's glorious world as mankind sins. Autonomously try to circumvent God's authority. Adam and Eve in the garden, they fall to the temptation to become like God, eating from the tree of knowledge of good and evil. And we might think, oh, well, that's not so bad, but their offspring are proved to do the same, to try to take for themselves, and Cain rises up and he kills his brother, right? And then we get to Genesis chapter 6, and the genealogy is not that long. Genesis chapter 6, and God looks at the whole of humanity and says, every intention of the thought of the heart of man is only evil continually. Ah, right? And God restarts the human race. He floods the earth, and Noah is found favor in the eyes of the Lord, and Noah is re-given this blessing and commission. God tells him and his sons, go, be fruitful, multiply, fill the earth, and subdue it. And that's where we get barbecue from. I love that, Genesis chapter 9. And right after that, it's ironic, honestly. Noah, he becomes a worker of the ground, and he's growing a vineyard. And by the fruit of the ground, he dishonors himself. He gets drunk on much wine and uncovers himself, and it's this whole tragic story of how Noah himself fails as well. And all of his progeny, all of his kids, they lead up to what we saw last week, Genesis chapter 11, the Tower of Babel. Again, might seem innocent when we first read it, but as Toby pointed out last week, that it was not just the Tower of Babel, it was a Tower of Man. Man circumventing God's authority and saying, no, we will become our own gods. We will make a name for ourselves. We won't do what you have divinely commissioned us to do. We will stick together and be this thing, right? So we're left with a question at the end of chapter 11. Right? God has restarted the human race. He's given a new Adam, and sin-sick human hearts have wrecked it, and so sin is this big problem in the world. What is God going to do about it? Is he just going to keep restarting the human race with another Adam? Right? He's not going to flood the earth again. And Genesis 12 seeks to answer this question that we're left with of what will God do about the problem of evil? How will he bless a humanity that has proven to take his blessing and throw it away for their own glory? What's he going to do about that? And it's here in Genesis 12 in which we're introduced to Abram, Father Abraham, right? Who knows the song? Father Abraham had many sons, and many sons had Father Abraham, and had one of that. Yeah, okay. All right. Well, yeah, I love that. That's awesome. So, yes, some of you are like, you know, let's keep going. Abram is, he is kind of a big deal, right? He's a hero of the faith, and he's talked about later on in the scriptures, all through the prophets and through the New Testament, but his story is interesting, to say the least. And I'm excited to get into it this morning. In order to get us into it, I want to first introduce you to the unlikely story of an athlete named John Scott. All right, when I say that, I realize I'm running a risk because some of you in here are like, I could care less about sports. I don't care about professional athletics or whatever. And the rest of you that do like sports, you're like, you just named the most generic name of a person ever, John Scott. Like, who is this guy? I guarantee you it's probably a guy that you have never heard of because he plays in the NHL, National Hockey League. How many of you guys are hockey fans? Okay, we got a total of 4. We're doing better than last service. 4 of you are hockey fans. Yeah, we are not Canadians, even though we're close to the border. So John Scott is a hockey player, NHL player. He's kind of known in the hockey league as what they call a goon or an enforcer. He was just like a big 6'8" type guy. I've got a picture of him up here that would, you know, check people, and he was the big presence on the hockey rink. And in a total of 285 NHL games over 8 seasons, John Scott scored a total of 5 goals. Not 0, but 285 games, he scored 5 goals. He had 6 assists, but like, I know nothing about hockey. That is bad, right? Like, we can all agree, 5 goals in 285 games as a professional, that's bad, right? He was, like, not a great hockey player. And in 2016, so there was a protocol in the league. I don't know why they started this. They were asking for something to happen. The league instigated this thing, I think, to try to get fans involved, where they would have fans vote on a player to send to the NHL All-Star Game. Yeah, right? So a couple of commentators were talking about this on air, and they made a joke, and they said, wouldn't it be funny if John Scott, this guy who scored 5 goals total, got voted to go to the All-Star Game, if he was an All-Star? Yeah, it would be funny. The NHL fans, like, they took that very seriously. It hit the Twitter sphere, and there were tens of thousands of votes for John Scott to go to the NHL All-Star Game. So much so that the league got involved. The league actually traded John Scott to another team, dropped him to a lower league, and tried to say he's ineligible. He can't play, right? And the fans wouldn't have it. Like, they, you know, they were calling up the league saying, like, you gotta let him play. And the league actually, they eventually called John Scott, and they told him, like, they were like, would your kids be proud of this if you played in the All-Star game knowing that you've only scored 5 goals? Oh man, brutal, right? So John Scott, a 0 in terms of pro hockey, right? He played pro hockey, but in terms of, you know, who he was a 0. And in the course of 2 months, he was playing in the All-Star game, okay? And not only was he playing in the All-Star game, scored 5 goals total in his career, he scored 2 goals in the semifinal to send his team through to the finals, which they won, right? So, incredible. The kicker is that when they were voting for the MVP, he wasn't on the ballot. Teams got together, they wrote him in, and John Scott became the MVP of the NHL All-Star Game in the season of 2016. Incredible. Like, 0 to hero story of this guy. And he got $1 million check for that. Just absolutely incredible. And I tell you that story, one, because it's really fun. Now you all know at least one name in the NHL that I guarantee you, like, a lot of NHL fans probably don't know, John Scott. But I tell you that because ultimately, the person we're looking at today, Abram, he's a lot like John Scott. We count him as a hero of the faith, and we sing, you know, Sunday school songs about him, but as we'll see, he was a 0 that God mercifully chose to represent the human race. He had no merit, and still God called him into relationship with himself, and it changed the course of human history. All right, and so we're going to look at the scriptures this morning, Genesis chapter 12. If you have strength to stand, would you stand with me in honor of God's word? We're going to read Genesis 12, and I'm going to read the whole chapter. I'm reading from the ESV. Now the Lord said to Abram, go from your country and your kindred and your father's house to the land that I will show you. And I will make of you a great nation, and I will bless you and make your name great, so that you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and him who dishonors you I will curse, and in you all the families of the earth shall be blessed. So Abram went as the Lord told him, and Lot went with him. Abram was 75 years old when he departed from Haran. And Abram took Sarai, his wife, and Lot, his brother's son, and all their possessions that they had gathered, and the people that they had acquired in Haran, and they set out to go to the land of Canaan. When they came to the land of Canaan, Abram passed through the land to the place of Shechem, to the oak of Moreh. At that time, the Canaanites were in the land. Then the Lord appeared to Abram and said, "To your offspring I will give this land." So he built there an altar to the Lord who had appeared to him. From there, he moved to the hill country on the east of Bethel and pitched his tent, with Bethel on the west and Ai on the east. And there he built an altar to the Lord and called upon the name of the Lord. And Abram journeyed on, still going toward the Negev. Now there was a famine in the land. So Abram went down to Egypt to sojourn there, for the famine was severe in the land. When he was about to enter Egypt, he said to Sarai, his wife, "I know that you are a woman beautiful in appearance. And when the Egyptians see you, they will say, 'This is his wife.' Then they will kill me, but they will let you live. Say you're my sister, that it may go well with me because of you, and that my life may be spared for your sake." When Abram entered Egypt, the Egyptians saw that the woman was very beautiful. And when the princes of Pharaoh saw her, they praised her to Pharaoh. And the woman was taken into Pharaoh's house. And for her sake, he dealt well with Abram. And he had sheep, oxen, male donkeys, male servants, female donkeys, and camels. But the Lord afflicted Pharaoh and his house with great plagues because of Sarai, Abram's wife. So Pharaoh called Abram and said, "What is this you've done to me? Why did you not tell me that she was your wife? Why did you say she's my sister so that I took her for my wife? Now then, here is your wife. Take her and go." And Pharaoh gave men orders concerning him, and they sent him away with his wife and all that he had. Let's pray. Lord, you are a God merciful and gracious. And Lord, we trust and believe that you have mercy and grace for us. And part of your mercy and grace for us is the scriptures. What you've given us, your word, to teach us and show us more about yourself and more about ourselves. Lord, and I pray that this morning that you would get our eyes onto you and that we would leave this morning reclaiming and remembering your promises and your great mercy and your great love for humanity. Lord, we are so grateful that humanity was not left to just keep spiraling downward like we see in the first 9 chapters of the book of Genesis. Lord, but you had a plan, and you enacted that plan through Abram. So show us more of yourself this morning, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. You can have a seat. I want to start by just giving you a little bit of Abram's backstory. And really, long story short, we know almost nothing about Abram. Really, we know a little bit from the genealogy in Genesis chapter 11 that Abram has 2 brothers and that his father is named Terah. And the whole family, they were living in the land of Ur, which is awesome. I love biblical names of places. I kind of wish that I lived in Ur. It sounds like a name from the south, you know? And where do you live? I live in Ur. Yeah, that would be cool. It's better than Vancouver, just saying. Less confusing too. Have you ever tried to explain where we live? It's so confusing. And at some point, they left the land of Ur of the Chaldeans. Terah, Abram, Sarai, his wife, and their nephew Lot, they moved to the land of Haran. And so there's some significant details there that I will point at later, but one of the things that I don't want us to miss is that nowhere in this genealogy is Abram or anybody else called righteous or nobody has found favor in the eyes of the Lord. We see in Noah's story, right, the line gets to Noah, and in Genesis chapter 6, we see that Noah has found favor in the eyes of the Lord. Abram, nothing is said like that about him. He's a guy that actually, we see later, God speaks to the next generation that has taken the land under the leadership of Joshua. He tells them this about Abram: "Long ago, your fathers lived beyond the Euphrates. Terah, the father of Abraham and of Nahor, and they, Abram included, served other gods. So Abram is this nobody. He's a zero, right? He has no mind for God. He has no heart for God. And God takes him, this pagan guy worshiping other idols, and says, you are going to serve me. And I'm going to stake my promise through you. That's Abram's backstory. No heart for God, no mind for God, and God used him as the basis for his cosmic call, not just to Abram and his family, but to the whole world. We see in Genesis chapter 12, 1 through 3, he says to Abram, go from your country and your kindred and your father's house to the land that I will show you. And I will make you a great nation, and I will bless you and make your name great so that you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and him who dishonors you, I will curse. And in you, all the families of the earth will be blessed. The calling of Abram and the promise that God gives to Abram is God's answer to a colossal problem. The colossal problem that is outlined in Genesis chapters 3 through 11, and we touched on it earlier, but mankind is spiraling out of control, right? God has restarted the human race, but the human race is shown to be infected by sin. If we were to sum up Genesis 3 through 11 in a couple of verses, we might turn over to what Paul says in Romans 3, 10 through 12. No one is righteous, no, not one. No one understands, no one seeks for God. All have turned aside. Together they have become worthless. Humanity, left to their own devices, will not choose God. They will not. And Genesis 3 through 11 makes that evidently clear. God has got to do something to intervene, to change the affections of man's heart towards himself. And so he does. And he chooses a pagan idol worshiper zero named Abram to make a promise to and says, I'm gonna solve this problem myself. The humans that I've created, they may have rejected me, but I will bless them. And I will dwell with them. God loves humanity, and we see it right from the very start. And notice that his answer to the problem is exactly the opposite of what the people of Babel come together to do. We looked at it last week, 11:4, right? Come, let us build ourselves a city and a tower, a nation. We're going to come together, and we will do this. And we will come together and make a name for ourselves. And what does God say to Abram? I will make you a great nation. And I will bless you. And it's the same words. And I will make your name great. He's going to be the one to come and to do it. He has to. He's the only one that can. In response to humanity that is bent on asserting their own autonomy and authority, God says to Abram, I'm going to do these things. And the purpose of it all, verse 3, universal blessing, to bless all of the families of the earth. It's on the basis of this promise that God will set up a people, a kingdom. He will give them land, and he will use them to be a blessing to all the peoples of the earth. And so, yes, it is a promise to one man, but it's cosmic in its scope. This promise is a answer to a colossal problem, and it has to be. The scope of the promise has to be cosmic. And these promises that are made to Abram, they're not made because humanity deserved it. They're apportioned to Abram strictly on the basis of mercy. As Toby mentioned last week, God, when the people come together and they make this tower to the heavens, God looks down at them. He comes down to them. I still find that so funny. He comes down to them and mercifully says, if I leave them doing what they're doing, they will destroy themselves. There's no end to what they will do. And so mercifully, he disperses them. And it's mercy here that causes God to speak to Abram, because Abram did nothing to deserve all of these promises. Humanity has done nothing to deserve a God who would make these grandiose, incredible promises to Abram. So you may be thinking, and I think what this chapter does is hopefully makes us ask the question, why Abram? Why would God choose somebody like that, that's a no-name, nothing, zero? The answer? Because it pleased God to do so. Because it pleased God to choose somebody that had no merit and to say, I'm going to bless you. I'm going to make you somebody. And that question, why Abram, it's got to get flipped around. Why me? If you are a Christian, why do you get to share in the blessings that God has given to humanity? You don't deserve it. You don't. You didn't bring anything to the table. And God looked at you and said, I'm going to bless you and give mercy to you. If you are in Christ this morning, it is because of his mercy, not because of anything you did to earn it or deserve it. And maybe you've heard that 100,000 times, that it's based on mercy, but I just want to point out the theme from the beginning of Scriptures to the end of it is that God so loved the world that he chose to come and to... Well, yeah, at the beginning of the story, God shows his love for humanity, and that while they were still sinners, pagans worshiping other gods, he shows his love and that he mercifully speaks to them and reveals himself and blesses them. And that's a theme from the very beginning, all the way through. And I think that the call of Abram is also a reminder to us that God, he can save anybody. Right? Like if he saved Abram, a guy that had no thought, no mind for God, and called him out of that, then to the very worst of sinners, God can open their eyes and call them and mercifully save them. Amen? Amen. So there is hope there. There is so much hope there. God is a God that saves even people that seem so far off. And after God speaks to Abram, the attention of the narrative turns to Abram and his response, and I'll call this Abram's circuitous compliance that's detailed in the rest of the chapter, because while Abram responds in faith, his faith is less than resolute. In fact, like as we read, some of what is detailed here is like pretty sketchy. Abram, what are you doing, man? Okay? He's kind of like, I'll liken him to a kid who's initially enthusiastic about something, but wavers in their enthusiasm, you know, throughout the day. My daughter is like this all the time. We'll tell her, hey, do you want to go do a, you know, go, she did swim lessons last week for the first time. And we were like, you know, trying to amp her up for it. And she was thrilled about it until she got in the car and she was like, no. I don't want to go. For me, my parents took me to Disneyland. How many of you are Disneyland fans? Okay, a couple of you. Yep. And I think, I don't know, I was like 10 or 12. I was young, probably, when we went. My dad's over there. That's why I'm pointing over there. It's not just to Joe Schmill. But you're not confirming for me. Okay, great. So I was young. And my dad, they took us to Disneyland, and I was, like any kid, I was pumped about it, you know? Like, we're going to Disneyland, this is going to be awesome. And then I got there, and I saw the size of the rides, right? The roller coaster California Screamin'. Right? How many of you guys have been on that before? Roller coaster enthusiasts are a rare and awesome breed. We bond over things such as California Screamin'. But as a, you know, 10 or 12 year old, I looked at that thing and I was like, nope. Right? My enthusiasm for Disneyland, which was here, waned to like here in a matter of milliseconds, and I wanted nothing to do with it. And like dads do, my dad somehow prodded me into getting in line with him, into going on this roller coaster. And so I'm like working up the courage as I'm in line, hearing the screams of all the people, thinking, what am I doing? And then I finally get up to the turnstile. And, you know, like the car is sitting there waiting for me, and I'm like, no way. I am not sitting down. And I think my dad said something like, sit down. You know, like, strap in. We're doing this thing. And, you know, the end of the story is awesome because for the next 6 weeks, I wouldn't shut up about it. I was like, yeah, that was the greatest thing ever. So I'm so glad my dad didn't scar me is what I'm trying to say. I'm not publicly shaming him. But this is like, it's like what Abraham does, right? He's like initially really enthusiastic. He goes, he went. But there's other things here that show us like, actually, maybe his enthusiasm is not so forward as we would like to believe. So I want to just first point out that Abraham responds with a legitimate faith in God. He legitimately responds to God's call. Verse 4, so Abram went as the Lord told him. Praise God. And this was not an easy thing for Abram to do. I really want to point that out. Right? Agrarian society, like he did not have a Ford F-250. He did not have a big, strong friend like Brian Jones to come and like haul all of his big furniture. He was driving his cattle and carrying everything he had on his back, walking hundreds of miles, not to move into a new house, but to go find a place that was habitable for him to live with all of his people, right? So this is like no small thing. And the fact that Abram heard the call and went shows that his faith was legitimate. And later on in the text, it's important that we recognize that Abram is not just he's not just hearing God's call and all of these promises and thinking like, well, that sounds pretty good. Like, yeah, I want those promises. Abram is following the God of the promise. Right, it's made clear later, verse 7, after he gets into Shechem in the land of Canaan, the Lord appears to him again. And he says, to your offspring I will give this land. So Abram finally sees, okay, this is the land that God is promising me. And he builds an altar to the Lord who had appeared to him. He worships. He worships God. Verse 8, again. He keeps going and he camps, and there he builds an altar to the Lord and he calls upon the name of the Lord. Everything in the text indicates that he has dropped his worship of other gods and he's following the God of the promise. That he's genuinely worshiping, he's setting up altars to worship the one true God, and it's not just an internal thing, it's an external thing. That he's setting up these pillars or whatever they would have been, people coming across them would have seen this is different than the Canaanite gods. This is an outward sign of Abram's worshiping somebody completely different, God, the God of the Bible. All right, and I want to make a quick connection. Ryan mentioned that we are doing baptisms on Easter. I'm so thrilled. I'm pumped about that. I'm pumped to pack this place out and celebrate because that's what it's about. Baptism is not this magical thing, you know, that the water does something incredible to your body and you just become, I don't know, pure afterward. What Jesus did is he's given it as a sign for believers to outwardly express what they internally believe, is to tell a whole bunch of people. And a whole bunch of people will be there that morning, that Jesus is my Lord and Savior in the midst of a land of exiles. Because you and I, if you are a Christian, we are called strangers and exiles in this world. And so what baptism is that outward sign that my allegiance is to Christ. And I'm dying with him, and I'm being raised to new life. And so if you have never been baptized, that's what that is. And I would so encourage you. It doesn't matter if you are 10 years old or if you are 80 years old. If you believe in Jesus as your Lord, you should get baptized, right? Come talk to me or Toby or Ryan about that. We'd love to tell you more. Abram had a legitimate faith in God. It was expressed outwardly. It was expressed in his action of going. And while Abram responded in a genuine faith to God's call, if we look a little closer, his faith isn't quite as radical as we first seemed to believe. His relocation to another land is rather lethargic, right? You might be thinking, like, how so? Because it says in the text that he received the promise, and then verse 4, Abraham went. But we read back in the genealogy, back in Genesis chapter 11, that Abram and his family, they traveled from Ur to Haran at some point. Right, so I got a couple maps up here. Ur is down here. I mean, this is like hundreds of miles. It's pretty incredible, this journey. So he travels from Ur to Haran, and he travels with his father, with his wife, and with Lot. Later on, in the book of Nehemiah and in the book of Acts, we read that the Lord called Abram not when he was in Haran, which is what it looks like in the text. It looks like he's in Haran, and that he got his call then, and he immediately went. Nehemiah 9:7 makes it clear that this is God speaking. You are the Lord, the God who chose Abram, or this is Nehemiah speaking. You are the Lord, the God that chose Abram and brought him out of Ur of the Chaldeans. And later in Stephen's speech in Acts chapter 7, Stephen says, the God of glory appeared to our father Abraham when he was in Mesopotamia before he lived in Haran and said to him, go out from your land and from your kindred and go into the land that I will show you. And so while at face value it looks like, yes, he immediately went, it was actually a pretty lethargic move. Who knows? I mean, it could have been 20 years, 30 years, 40 years before Abram finally departed and made it into the land of Canaan. He camped in Haran with his family for who knows how long, right? And Abram's obedience is also marked by a lax observance of God's command. Explicitly, God states to Abram, go from your country and your kindred and your father's house to the land that I will show you. Chapter 11 makes it clear that Abram goes because his father went to Haran. So he goes with his father to Haran, and then it's only after his father dies there that he then travels into the land of Canaan, and he brings Lot with him. And you might be thinking, like, oh, that's rather harsh, dude. You know, that, like, you expect him to follow exactly the letter of the law here. I mean, hindsight is 20/20. We know the rest of the story. But I think it's pretty telling that later on, Lot becomes kind of a nuisance for Abram, right? In Genesis chapter 13, the land won't support both of them. And so they eventually do, they have to separate. And then in Genesis chapter 14, Abram has to go and rescue Lot because he's in trouble. And then in 18 and 19, again, Lot is living, who knows why, in the city of Sodom and Gomorrah, and God says he's gonna destroy it, and Abram's like, no, wait. You need to go and rescue Lot first. There's somebody righteous living there, right? And so it's actually shown that, man, there's consequences for the fact that he laxly or loosely observed God's commands by bringing Lot with him and by going out with his father. Everything here seems to indicate that Abram sees his own circumstances, and in seeing them, he takes everything into account about them but God. He seems to make his own decisions without a thought for God and why he would ask him to do these very things, to leave his father's house and his kindred and go. And we see it even clearer in verses 10 through 20, that Abram, he has a loose resolve in the promises that God has made. Verse 10, Now there was a famine in the land, so Abram went down to Egypt to sojourn there. Famine is a big deal, right? And the famine was severe. And so on one hand, you're thinking, yes, like, if there's a famine in the land, then Abram, you got to go find a way to support your family. But at the same time, everything about this narrative points to the fact that, again, Abram looked at his circumstances and said, I'm going to do all of this based on my own strength and my own thought about what is best. And what is he doing by leaving the land? What did God just promise to him? This is the land that I'm going to give you. And Abram's like, nope, I'm going to go. I'm going to go to Egypt. So he gives it up right there. It's almost comical. And that's not even the worst part, right? Verse 11, when he was about to enter Egypt, he said to Sarai, his wife, I know that you are a woman beautiful in appearance, and I wish the sentence ended right there, right? That Abram was just like making a really nice compliment to his wife, but no, man, this is crazy. And when the Egyptians see you, they will say, this is his wife. Then they will kill me, and they will let you live. Say you are my sister, that it may go well with me because of you, and that my life may be spared for your sake. What? What are you doing, Abram? Like, for start, like, this is not the main takeaway from this message, but husbands, never use your wives as human meat shields. That is not okay. Abram, like, what are you doing? Crazy, right? But not only that, he has just given up this promise of land, and now he's giving up, like, how is Abram just going to produce a great nation by himself? Nope. So what else is he giving up? Like, it's the whole thing. He's giving up all of the promises that God has just made. It's incredible, and it's crazy. He's willing to give it all up for self-preservation. Again, Abraham sees his own circumstances, and he takes everything into account but God. He has genuine faith, and that's to be made clear and commended, but when his faith is tested with famine and with fear, Abram's faith wavers as he starts to trust himself and make his own decisions. And, you know, some of you are thinking, like, wow, this sermon is titled Zero to Hero, and you are really ragging on Abram. Like, is there a redemption story here? And the point of this story is that Abram is not a hero. He's not. He's slow to obey. He's flighty, and he's cowardly. The mercy that God showed him in calling him out of his old life and into his new life did not instantly change him into a new person that perfectly obeyed all of God's commands. I think we need to see that. God mercifully calls him to a new life. Abram is still Abram. Abram still struggles with his own sin. The point of Genesis chapter 12 is not Abram's unwavering faithfulness to follow the call. The point of Genesis chapter 12 is God's unwavering faithfulness to fulfill his promises in spite of what humanity might do to jeopardize them. The point for us is to see a God who loves and blesses and tends for his chosen people despite how badly they might botch it. God is a God that mercifully calls Abram to himself, and he is mercifully going to continue to fulfill his promise, even though Abram tries to give it all away. Just like Abram, your faith, you are not constant. You are inconsistent. I bet your faith wavers. And yes, we should follow the call. We should obey the Lord. We should trust in him. But I'm just stating what is evident in this text, that our faith will waver when it's tested. And so what is your confidence in? Your ability to hold on or God's ability to pull through and stay faithful to his promises? Because he's going to do it. And he does it miraculously right here as he shows his consistent character, remaining faithful to his promise. Verse 17, the Lord intervened. He afflicted Pharaoh and his house with great plagues because of Sarai, Abram's wife. So Pharaoh called Abram and said, "What is this you've done to me? Why did you say she's my sister so that I took her for my wife? Now then, here's your wife. Take her and go." And Pharaoh gave men orders concerning him, and they sent him away with his wife and all that he had. Abram, he did everything wrong. And God didn't let Abram botch the plan. God intervenes. He plagued Pharaoh, and he gives Abram his wife back, and he drives him back into the land of Canaan with more than he left with. And this is, it's just a precursor, a little exodus from what we are going to see later on in this series, is it not? A people that barely know their God. And God raises up somebody to lead them out and to plunder the Egyptians, and he blesses them. It's incredible. God remains faithful to his promise, despite Abram's faith wavering at a critical moment. God saved Abram by his mercy, and God will sustain Abram by his mercy, not by Abram's ability to obey perfectly. And now we replace Abram with us, because God saved you, not by your merits, not by how great you are, but by his mercy. And God is going to sustain you, not by how good you do, not how by how well you obey, but by his mercy. Do you believe that? Do you believe that he will cause you to make it to the end? That he holds your footsteps secure? No matter what you may face, no matter how your faith may waver, no matter what you are up against, if you are facing a season like Abram where you are surveying the landscape and it looks like famine, like, Lord, how are you going to pull me through this? I've got to do something drastic here and look at myself and look at all my options and go the way that looks best to me. If that's the season you're in, the Lord is going to remain faithful to you to fulfill his promises. And he has made so many of them in the scriptures to you. Philippians 1:6, he who began a good work in you will bring it to completion at the day of Jesus Christ. Do you believe that? Or is your trust in yourself? And look, the story of Abram is incredible, because right here, Abram is a complete zero. Right, he gives up his own wife. And yet, Genesis chapter 22, God is going to test his faith with the hardest test that I believe any man has ever had to go through. He says, give up, come and offer your only son on the altar. And how does Abram respond? In faith. And if that doesn't give you confidence that the Lord has a plan for you to grow your faith, even in the midst of famine, then I don't know what will. Because Abram was a zero, and God said, I am going to bless you and keep you, and you are going to ascend that mountain, and you will offer your son. I will grow your faith. Do you believe that God is going to grow your faith? He will. He will do it. He's a God of his promises, and he's consistent in his character to fulfill them. One last thing that I want us to see in the text here, God is resolved to provide blessing to humanity. God uses even what is messed up and wrong and bad. He doesn't waste things. And he didn't waste what Abram does here in disobedience. When I was reading this week, I saw something kind of for the first time, and I just thought, wow, Lord, you snuck that in there. Verse 16, small detail, after Abram gives up his wife, Pharaoh gives him all of these gifts. It says that Abram had sheep and oxen and male donkeys, male servants, female donkeys, and camels. So eventually, Abram, when he gets his wife back, he leaves with all of those things, and more importantly, he left with those people. You remember the promise? 12:3, in you, all of the nations of the earth will be blessed. And we tend to think of the nation of Israel as being this vehicle by which God is eventually going to save people through his son. And yes, that's totally true. But all along the way, he is grafting people in from different tribes and nations and tongues, and he's bringing them into the presence of the living God to be saved, and he does it right here in Genesis chapter 12, right after he gives the promise. As these slaves that were once serving the Egyptian gods are brought into the family of Abram to serve Abram and serve the God that Abram worships. Right there at the start. It's incredible. God is resolved to bless a humanity that is hell-bent on running away from him. He is such a merciful God. And so we're gonna respond to his mercy in worship, and worship team is gonna help us to do that. If you wanna go ahead and get ready. The thing that I hope that you will walk out of here with, if you are a Christian, if you are a born-again believer, my hope is that you would walk out of here reveling in the fact that just like Abram, you too, you're a zero. You are. And if that offends anybody, I'm not sorry. Because you bring nothing. No amount of merit, no amount of works could move the needle on God's feelings for you. The only thing that moves the needle is God sending his son, Jesus, to stand in your place. And he does it because of mercy. He mercifully gives you a savior. And so revel this morning in being a zero, and being just like Abram, somebody that didn't deserve mercy, but God poured mercy out anyway. He is steadfast to his promise, and he has sealed that promise by the blood of his son, Jesus, on the cross. So let me pray. We're going to take the elements here right after we sing a song of response, and so I'll lead us on in that in a moment, but let me pray to close us. Father, you are so kind to us. You are so kind to provide a story like this where we don't look at this model person, Abram, and just think, wow, how could I ever be like that? God, we are so much more like this than we think. Our hearts are so prone to wander from you. I know that for myself, Lord. I am prone to wander. I do. I feel it. And daily, I have to remind myself of your promises and your truth, that it's not based on my ability. It's based on the fact that you are a God that's faithful to your promise, and you promise to keep working on us, to keep working on me, to keep working on your people. Father, I pray for anybody here this morning that is just struggling with the weight of their own failures and sin, that you would remind them of how merciful of a God you are, to cover over our blunders and mistakes by the blood of your son, Jesus Christ. We could never hope to deserve such a savior, such a hero in our stories. And yet, he's given to us freely. And we thank you. We respond and worship to you genuinely, truly, because of how awesome you are. It's in Jesus' good name that we pray. Amen. Amen. Would you stand? Let's respond and worship together. For a moment. We have the opportunity this morning to participate in one of the sacraments that Jesus has given us to remember him by. And we've just sung, I believe and I will follow you. Whether the storms are there or I'm in a season of joy. And the reality is we are constantly, our lives are in flux and changing and we're going through different seasons. And so it is so good that what the Lord has done is given us this table as a reminder that it is not based on our work and our efforts to stay the course. Yes, we got to have our eyes on him, but it is based on this table, what this table represents, that we are looked at by the God of glory. And he says, you are my son or daughter in whom I am well pleased, because the blood of Jesus has covered over and cleansed you from all sin for all time. He will sanctify you completely, and you will be glorified, all because of what is represented here in this table. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. And so we have the opportunity this morning to remember our Savior in this way. If you are here this morning and you are not a believer, we just ask you to refrain from taking the elements. And it's not because we don't want you to partake in this meal. Actually, we desperately want you to partake in this meal with us. And so if you're here this morning, you have questions about that, about why we would ask you to refrain, simply put, it's just because this meal is for people who have put their faith in Jesus as Lord and Savior. And if you haven't done that, man, don't wait. Come and talk to myself or Toby or Ryan after the service. We would love to talk to you more about what that means and what that looks like. For the rest of you that have trusted in Jesus, while we sing this next song, come gather the elements, take them back to your seat, and then we'll take communion all together after the song. And so, church, the tables are open. Let's share in this together.
My heart, Lord, take and seal it.
Let's stand as we sing that again. Above all else, I adore your name. Above all else, to my heart to sing your praise. One more time. Above all else, I adore your name. Above all else, to my heart to sing your praise. The highest, the highest.
God takes and covers our wander-prone hearts by his body and his blood. On the night he was betrayed, Jesus took bread and he broke it and said, "This is my body broken for you." Let's partake in the Lord's body broken for us. And in the same way, he took the cup, saying, "This cup represents the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." Let's take the cup together. Father, what a merciful thing you have done in sending your Son, Jesus Christ, to atone for all of our sins. Lord, past, present, and future, they're paid for. And we are grateful this morning that we have this poignant reminder of what it cost. It cost everything. And yet you are willing to offer your own Son, and Jesus was willing to offer his body and his blood for us on the basis of mercy, not on the basis of what we could do. Hallelujah, what a Savior we have in Christ. So we praise you this morning. We are so grateful for the reminder in the scriptures that we get that you are going to carry us through to the end. May we bank on that. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Go ahead and let's stand as we continue to worship with our last song together. Sorry, all the up and down, but it's probably good for us. We're going to close with the song that Ryan introduced last week that I think is going to be a really helpful anthem for us for this whole Torah series, because the whole thing points us to Jesus. Adam is the true and better, Christ is the true and better Adam, and then the next verse is about Isaac, who we'll get to soon, and then true and better Moses. And so we want to sing this and just be thankful for the Lord Jesus Christ.
Christ the true and better Adam, Son of God and Son of man, who when tempted in the garden never yielded, never sinned, and he who makes the many righteous brings us back to life. dying he reversed the curse, then rising crushed the serpent's head. Christ the true and better Isaac, humble son of sacrifice, who would climb the fearful mountain there to offer up his life. Lamb was paid upon the altar, Father's joy and only Son. Their salvation was provided. Oh, what full and boundless love. Sing amen.
So I want to leave you, because of Christ, with this blessing from the book of Numbers, chapter 6. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. And I expect that's going to happen because of Christ. God bless you. Good to worship with you today. Have a great week.